Hey guys, we are in the basement, and today, yes, today guys, we are gonna do part number three. That's right, part number three of the Nintendo versus Unisystem dedicated upright restoration. Yeah, I know, that's a lot to say, isn't it? But anyway, this is a top secret project, okay? And this is the last video, the last restore video. Not the last video, because in this video, we're gonna restore it and pretty much finish the game. And then later, we will reveal what this game is, because yes, this is a top secret project. And this game is actually going to somebody pretty cool. And the game that we're gonna put in there is also very cool, but I can't talk about it just yet. But for now, we're gonna restore this game and get it all ready. And in this video, honestly, we're gonna cover a lot of ground, okay? We got some painting to do. We're gonna replace side art. We have to put a new power supply in. T-molding, we're gonna put 3/4 inch T-molding on a 5/8 inch cabinet. So we've got a lot to do in this video. So anyway, enough of that. Let's just get to the garage and get to work on the Nintendo versus Unisystem. All right guys, let's go to the garage. All right guys, we are back in the garage, and yes, it is cold outside. I have the heater going. It's about, it's in the upper 40s right now, or about 10 degrees Celsius for my European friends. And yes, I have the propane heater going. It's about 70 degrees in here right now. I got the chill out of the garage and we are ready to work. Actually, I wanna turn the heater off though, because it's plenty warm in here right now. And we're about to do some painting, and I'm gonna have to open the garage for a little bit just so I can get some paint down here and not die from the fumes. But anyway, okay, so let's review. So in the last video, well, we did all the Bondo work and really got the cabinet prepped and patched up, and all the structural stuff was taken care of, and it looks really good actually. So right now we're ready to paint, and I wanna paint the base first. And I already have it all masked off here. I just threw some masking tape and paper towels, and we're just gonna hit the base here. I'm gonna do the three sides, the left, front, and the back, and then we'll turn it around and do the other side. We're probably gonna put the cabinet on its back because I need to address the front of the cabinet still. There's a little bit of Bondo work that we need to do still above the coin door that I don't think will take very long. But anyway, so what I wanna do is I'm gonna open the garage just so we can breathe okay in here. This is the real bummer about this time of the year. I mean, the weather right now is unusually cold. But you know, when I had to shut the garage and working here with paints and stuff, it gets really kind of toxic, and I hate it. And I know last year, doing that journey with the garage door shut, sanding, oh my God, that was, I gotta be a little more careful this year. Yes, I'm gonna invest in a dust mask. But right now, I just wanna hit this thing with some black paint, let it dry, we'll do a couple coats. I'm using my favorite Universal Satin Paint and Primer, Rust-Oleum, just a satin black. I thought about painting the base with a paintbrush and some of that oil-based Rust-Oleum black satin, but I'm gonna see how this goes with the rattle can. I think it's gonna go a lot faster. And like I said, I got it all masked off here, so we gotta make sure that we don't get any overspray on the cabinet. I don't like how that's doing that. Oh boy. And we're already getting overspray, so hang on. All right, that was a completely irritating way to start my day. So I had, I taped this all down and I put paper towel on top, which I did on the top and it worked out fine, but I didn't tape down the paper towel. And when I was spray painting, the paper towel kind of blew up, from the air from the aerosol can. And I got overspray all over this whole bottom here. And I'm like, ah, so I quickly took everything off and I sprayed some of this on here, spray paint graffiti remover. And it took the overspray right off, so. All right, I need to remask this and do a way better job than I did last time. And this is kind of why I wanted to almost do the brush, because this is irritating to have to, you know, worry about overspray and stuff, especially down here, because I don't want to get any of our paint on our gray. I mean, I don't want any black on this gray anywhere. So I'm gonna go ahead and just remask this off, and I'm gonna do a much better job. And then we'll paint this again. So hang on, let me just keep going here. I'm gonna remask this whole thing off and get it all ready for spray paint. Okay, let's try this again. This time I went crazy. I got cardboard, I got everything on here, masking tape, I used some paper towel to fill up large areas that weren't that critical, and all right, let's try this again. I should have just hit this with the oil paint and a brush. It's so much less prep work, but whatever. Oh, great. Are you kidding me? My can's clogged. There we go. All right, so I'm gonna keep going here and paint this whole thing. I think this will look really good when we're done. And let's hit the back. I'm gonna do a couple coats. All right, I'm gonna let that dry and then I'll come back and do a second coat and then we'll move on. All right, guys, it's been about an hour here. We're all dry. I have about two or three coats on there. The base looks okay. It's not amazing. It's not perfect. That wood was pretty chewed up, and you can kind of see a little bit of my Bondo work. I'm not too worried about it because it is just the base, and you're really not going to see it. So what I want to do right now is I'm going to put the wheels back on because I want to stand this cabinet up and then put it on its back so we can do the rest of the work. So we have to do a little bit of Bondo work in the front. And then we also need to paint the other side of the base. So I'm just gonna come in here and just screw these on really fast. There's just four screws holding these wheels on. And these wheels were kind of ineffective before because this whole base was trashed. And this piece of wood down here is just totally ineffective. So I'm gonna go ahead and just screw these eight screws on the wheels here. And then we'll stand the cabinet up and then go to the next steps. So I'm gonna go do that right now. All right, I got the wheels on. I'm gonna go ahead and stand the cabinet up and then we're gonna rotate it. We're gonna put it on its back. Actually, the one thing I wanna show you guys is I decided to redo some of the Bondo over here. I did this while I was waiting for the base to dry. But I was looking at this and I was rubbing my finger over here, and this was our really big job we did. I was rubbing my finger over it and I just kept feeling a bump and it was bothering me. So I came in here and put some more Bondo down and then resanded it with like 600 grit, and now there's like no bump at all. So it's like totally smooth. So way better than it was. So all right, let me go ahead here and stand this guy up. All right, and now we're gonna work with it on its back. And I'm leaving all of the cardboard on here because we gotta paint the other side of the base. So we should be able to wheel this around now, which I couldn't do before because the base was hosed. So let's see how well this holds up, and it does. All right, so we're gonna work on this now with the game on its back. And I guess we could pull this off. Yeah, I'm gonna pull, I think, all this masking tape off of here. Because the side we're gonna paint is that other side. So let me go ahead here and we're gonna just rip all this masking tape off. And there's no overspray. So I'm not ready to do the gray paint yet. I'm gonna do that last because we got it. I'm gonna do it all at once. So I'm gonna wait until all of our Bondo work is done. Okay. So the base looks pretty good, actually, you know? It really does. I don't know if you guys can tell, but It looks good. All right, so let's put the game on its back. Just kind of looking around here. And then we're gonna spray paint. I gotta take the key off the back door. Don't wanna lay it on the key. So I'm gonna go ahead and just put the game on its back, and then we're gonna work on it this way. Follow me. All right, this back door kind of wants to fall off. I'm gonna have to fix it because there's a piece of wood on the bottom of it that kind of makes it lock into the lip. And that piece of wood is kind of busted right now, and I'm gonna have to repair it. So I'm gonna tape the back door on just so it doesn't come off when we lean it back. And then we'll repair it later. All right. Okay. All right, so the work I want to do right now, besides painting the other side of the base, so we're gonna have to paint this side, but I want to take a look at a way, I want to figure out a way to cover this crack up right here. And it's not too bad. It really looks like it's mostly cosmetic. I don't know if someone kicked this thing or what, but I'd like to cover that up. And we've got our paint, so I'm probably gonna throw a little bit of Bondo on there. Now, we're gonna have to take the coin door to really properly do this. And I don't think that's gonna be too bad, actually, to get this coin door off. No, it's not. There's just a little Molex connector. And then 2, 4, 5, 6 screws. So, what should we do first? Should we paint the base? And then do that while the base is drying? I think so. So I'm gonna go ahead and mask this off, and then we're gonna hit this with the rattle can and just finish off the base. All right, I got the everything all masked off here. So I'm just gonna hit this side real quick with the black, and then we're done. This black paint part is kind of annoying. I want to be done with it. Because after we get all the black paint spray painted, there's not that much left to do as far as painting, and we could do it with the garage door shut, and it's not nearly as messy. But so I'm gonna go ahead here and just hit this, and I'll do a couple coats. All right, I'm gonna let that dry, and then we'll come back. Okay guys, we are mostly dry here. It's a little tacky. I removed all of the cardboard and tape and all that, but what I want to do right now is I want to see if we can address this crack in the front, and I want to just very tastefully Bondo this. Let me show you guys. You guys see that crack right there? So the particle board is cracked right here, and in order to do this, what I want to do is just sand this down a little bit, and then we're going to put some Bondo on it. But I need to take the coin door off to really do this. And the coin door is just held on here with, like, looks like 6 nuts. So we're gonna come on in the inside here with my nut driver. And just undo these and then pull the coin door off. Okay, so we have these little nuts and these little holder things. So I'm just gonna take all those off. And I'm trying to do this so they don't drop into the cabinet. One just fell in. So I'm gonna go ahead and get the rest of them off. Oops, I was a little too zoomed in there. So I'm gonna go ahead and get the rest of these nuts off, and then we should be able to just, the coin door should just come right off. there's a ground wire that came off here. So that's all of them, and then we should be able to unplug this Molex connector and just remove the coin door. Okay, let's see. Oh, we got one more right here. Okay. So we should be able to just pull the coin door right off now, like so. And now we can really see our crack. So, trying to figure out how I want to address this. It's a hairline crack. And I don't want to make too big of a repair here. So I'm just wondering how we want to address this. I almost think we should glue it a little bit, because this crack goes all the way through. Boy, that's going to be tough to glue. Not really sure how to do this. It looks like someone like just kicked that whole thing. I'd love to put some glue in here. I just don't know how to get it in there. Yeah, this crack goes all the way through too. You know, these games took such a beating. I'm really worried that if we repair this and we don't do it really nice and good and strong, that when this game gets moved, this board's gonna flex and the Bondo's just gonna pop off. Seems a little risky. I'm tempted to leave it alone, honestly, because I think we could make it worse. And I don't want to make it worse. I mean, it's not that noticeable. What to do? Really tempted to leave it alone. Because I don't want to make it worse. And I don't want it, I don't want whatever our work, that we, whatever work we do here, I don't want it to fall off at the guy's house, because that would be bad. So there were some staples that came in from the top here that go right into this wood here on the edge. Should we go for it? Or do we leave it? Man, I'm tempted to leave it. Let me think about this. All right, here's what I decided to do. I'm gonna reinforce it, okay? So it can't move, because originally they had staples going in from the top here into the edge of that piece of wood. And so I'm gonna come in with my staple gun and I'm gonna try to make it so it can't flex, okay? And I already threw a couple staples in here just as a test. And I'm just using my cheapo nail gun. And I'm using these, I don't know how long these are, but these little staples here. And I'm just coming in from the top. I already did a test here to make sure it went all the way through. And so I threw in one here and one here. And these are on either side of the crack. And I'm gonna come in here and just throw a couple more and just kind of reinforce that area. And I think, and now it doesn't flex at all, which is good. So let's just throw a couple more in here. And these are totally out of sight. So they originally had one here and here and here. Oh yeah, it's totally not moving now. Okay. So that feels a lot better. And it's not flexing at all on the front. I'm just trying to get the nail gun to the edge here. Okay. So I think that's going to be good. All right, so now we have to decide if we want to do the Bondo. I mean, we made it more structurally sound, and this isn't flexing anymore, okay? So do we sand this down and then try to put a little bit of Bondo on there? I think I'm going to do it. As long as I know that that Bondo's not going to flex and crack after it leaves my house, I feel a little more comfortable doing this. I mean, it is very, very, very tempting just to leave it alone. Because I don't want to make it worse, because it's very, you know, that little crack in the front, you can barely notice it. It's barely visible. You have to like hunt for it. But I think I can tastefully do this with just a little bit of Bondo in here, just to fill up the crack, and then we'll, and then just tastefully paint over it. So let's go ahead and put this game back on its back, which I'm getting really sick of doing. All right. Yeah, so way better. It doesn't flex at all anymore. So those staples really just firm that thing right up. So I'm gonna mix a little bit of Bondo, and I think I'm gonna very carefully just put it over this crack, and then we'll sand it by hand, because I don't want the area to be bigger than it needs to be. I don't want a giant wide area. So let me mix up some Bondo and we'll fill that in. Okay, I mixed up some Bondo. I'm gonna do this with a razor blade. I just don't want a ton of Bondo in this area. I just want it right in that crack. And I'm gonna see if this will work. And I'm just gonna try to fill it in with the Bondo and this razor blade and see if we can just get it inside that crack or right on it. And I don't want my area to be too wide. And then I'm gonna sand this by hand very carefully. Okay, well it's going inside the crack, which is good. So is this okay what I'm doing? I'm just figuring this out as I go, guys. I just, you know, I think it's very easy for these repairs to go south, and I don't want to make it worse. I mean, that is my number one priority. I want it to be better than I had than I got it, you know. And we're just trying to hide some of these cosmetic flaws, and I'm just trying to very tastefully do that right now. And I think this will work. I think it's gonna work actually great. So if you guys can see what I'm doing in there. I just don't want a big, really wide Bondo repair job right here. I just want it right on this seam, and then I want to sand it smooth. And then hopefully you'll never notice it was there. Now I'm wondering what to do about these big gouges. Again, that's something I'm wondering if I should just leave, or should we just attempt to fill it in a little bit and then we'll paint it. Let's see how this goes in here. And it might work okay. Don't want really big repair areas. All right, so I'm gonna let this dry, and I'm gonna actually take a paper towel and wipe off as much of that as I can. All right, so let's let that dry and we'll come back and see what happens, but a little hairy. All right, guys, actually, the Bondo's all dry. I actually already sanded it. I was excited to see what would happen, and I gotta tell you, it turned out actually really awesome. I did it all by hand. I sanded it by hand. I used 220 grit sandpaper. I put it around this rubber thing that's like a part from my car, and I just kind of came in here and just sanded it all by hand, and really, it disappeared. Now, the other area, though, it's okay, but it's not going to be visible, these little areas here. I just don't want to go crazy on these because I think this could go south. But I think those will look just fine when we paint them, and it's better than it was. And you cannot see that when you're looking at the game. It's in such a spot here that it's just not easily detectable. So, all right, so here's what we're going to do. We are ready to paint the gray color. Okay, this is the moment of truth here. And I've already cleaned the cabinet. I wiped it all down with Simple Green. I let it dry. So we have to paint this corner. We have to paint that edge and the top and then that crack. And then also up here, somebody did a little bit of work on this edge in here. So we're gonna have to paint this as well. I sanded off the white paint they had on there. It's funny, I mean, you know, someone really did do some Bondo work on this cabinet. And so I just been going through and kind of redoing it. And we're gonna make it look better, okay? So we need to mix our paint up. Now I went to Ace Hardware again. I said this in the last video, but I went to Ace and I brought a piece of the cabinet with me and I had them color match. And my God, they nailed it. It's like dead nuts on. So we're gonna stir up some of this paint. And I'm gonna use a very small foam roller right here. I thought about using a brush. I'm gonna use a foam roller because I don't want any brush marks. And I really am gonna do my best to make this touch-up paint be invisible. I don't want anyone to see it. And that's the goal here. And I think with the foam roller, you can get a little more subtle results. So that's what I'm hoping. So we're gonna try that. Now this paint is a paint and primer in one. So we should be okay. And yes, and no, it's not brown paint. Paint and primer in one. I'm curious about recoat time. I like to put at least two coats on. Stir thoroughly, blah, blah, blah. Space, evaluation. So, okay, why doesn't it talk about a recoat time on here? Raw paint on wall, look at color in different lights. So the purpose of this pint is to do a color sample. So it doesn't have like the full instructions on here because when you go to Ace and you want to paint your dining room a color, they're like, oh, well, we'll mix you up a pint and you can see it if you like it. So they don't really have the full instructions on here, but it's a latex-based paint. So I want to put two coats on. I might go online after this, after the first coat, and just see what they say about recoat. And yes, it's gray. It's not brown. This is not brown paint. All right, so let's mix this up really well. And I also got a little foam brush, because I don't want to leave any lines or marks. So I'm going to use foam for everything. And we don't have a lot to paint at all. This is gonna take like 2 minutes. All right, so I think that's pretty mixed up. So let's just pour a little in here. And I buy these cheapo tray liners because they're only $2 and I'm not like on a ladder or something, so I don't really need it to be super rigid. But these are designed to go into like a metal tray. These are liners. All right, so we wanna do this very, very restrained, and so I'm gonna have as little paint as possible on this roller, and let's see what happens. So why don't we try this corner first, okay? And I already cleaned this off. I'm just gonna make sure there's no dust on here. So let's see what happens here. All right, so we're just gonna leave that. I'm not gonna go any further than that, okay? So right now you can see the paint, but hopefully when it dries, it disappears. That's the plan here. So let's come over here and I'm gonna do this edge also. The foam roller is leaving a little bit of a texture, which might be okay because this cabinet, this vinyl does have a very subtle texture to it. So hopefully it'll be okay. But I sure hope this works, because this is really the moment of truth. I'm really banking on the paint just kind of vanishing. So let's go ahead here. I feel like I have too much paint on this. So let's come in here and just kind of touch this up. Just like so. All right. I might come over that after this dries, like thoroughly, like for a day, I might go over this with like 2000 grit sandpaper just to smooth it all out. All right, so let's let that dry. And then we're gonna come over here and we'll do this area that we patched, which is right in here. All right, let me put some paint on here. So I'm gonna go up a little higher here. I'm definitely painting more than I planned on right now. I'm wondering if I should try to wipe some of that off. I wanted to go to that edge though, because we sanded all this. Let me just see if I can get rid of some of this. Don't want to make a mess. And I am probably going to wet sand this afterwards to really smooth it out. I'm going to come back over that with my roller just to even out what I just wiped. There we go. All right, we're going to let this dry and then we're going to come back. I may put on another coat. I'm wondering how soon to put that on. Actually, we forgot to touch up the top here. So let's go ahead and do that real quick. And I think I'm gonna use this foam brush to touch up the, to touch up our little Bondo area. So let's kind of come in here and just very carefully just touch this up. I'm trying to use less paint. Looks good. All right. So how's it look? All right, so let's let this dry and then we'll come back and put another coat on. I am gonna actually go online and just out of curiosity, read what they say for this brand of paint for the recoat time. That looks pretty good. So if this stuff dries the same color as the cabinet, it's gonna really disappear. So that's the hope. All right, guys, we'll be back. All right, guys, it's been about 45 minutes or so and the paint's mostly dry. And yeah, that color is an exact match. I mean, look at that. You can't even tell where it's painted. And so very, very happy with that. That's a great, great, great color match. The thing is, I don't know what the formula is. Like, don't ask, because I don't know. They just mixed it and made it. They matched my sample and then gave me a pint. And I didn't get any kind of sticker or anything on there with the code. So I have no idea what the code is. But it is dead nuts on. So I'm going to go ahead and put a second coat on real quick. I don't even think I need to sand this. I mean, it's really not detectable where we painted. So we might just leave it alone. But I'm gonna come in here and just do a quick second coat. And I'm doing thin coats. I'm trying not to go too crazy here because I do want it to stay subtle. And we'll just kind of come in here. I'm tempted to just do this edge. All right, so we'll just do that. Let that dry. And then I'll come and do the other areas as well. So I'm gonna go ahead and put a second coat everywhere with my roller. And we'll let it dry overnight, and then we'll come back. But yeah, it's looking good. All right, guys, it is the next day here, and the paint is all dry, and it looks really good, actually. That's a really good paint match. You gotta really look and try to get it in the right light to see where the touch-up paint is, which is excellent. So I'm really happy with that. So, okay, so since, and by the way, I did put the coin door back on too. So, and that little repair right here was a massive success. I'm really glad I did that. I was a little hesitant at first, but it was worth it. Okay, so what I want to do now, since the game is on its back, I want to put the T-molding on, and let's talk really quick about this. So this is a particle board cabinet, okay, and Nintendo did some particle board cabs really late in the game, you know, R-Type and the Versus Unisystem, the dedicated play choice, and then also some of the later Donkey Kongs and Popeyes were made in the US with particle board cabinets. And when they did those, they used typically a 5/8 inch cabinet with an offset T-molding groove, okay? Meaning this groove that's in here is not centered, okay? And if you look out there, it's impossible to find 5/8 inch black T-molding with an offset groove. It was possible at one point because Bill at Chomping Quarter did white offset 5/8 inch T-molding. He's since sold out and isn't planning on making any more because I don't know if there's not a demand or what, but he never made black and no one makes black. And so I was talking to Fetish Boy Sean Williams, my friend, and he thought, based on his experience and what he has seen on these Nintendo cabinets, that Nintendo was using 3/4 inch T-molding and then trimming the sides of it, okay? So again, this groove is offset. Now I have 3/4 inch T-molding right here. I bought this at Twisted Quarter. I bought 22 feet of it, it's really cheap. And if you put this in the groove, you'll notice that on the left here, the T-molding lines up exactly with the cabinet, and then on the right side, it hangs off a little bit. So what we're gonna do, and we believe this is what Nintendo did, is we're gonna use wider T-molding than the cabinet, okay? And one side is gonna be lined up, and then the other side is not. And then Uncle Tiggy, told me to go on Amazon and get one of these Quad Pro trimmers, okay? And this is meant for trimming like countertops, like the edge banding, and it can also be used for T-molding. It's about 40 bucks. They have two models. They have a tungsten blade one and then like just a normal steel one. I did buy the more deluxe tungsten blade. And then the idea here is we're gonna put our T-molding on and then just come in here with this thing and then trim the edge of it, okay? And that's just gonna trim off the excess that's hanging off, okay? And I wanna start on the bottom here. And I'm gonna throw probably a nail or two in this. So let's come in here and I'm just gonna take my T-molding and we're gonna hammer it in. And I do have my glue gun on hand just in case we have some loose T-molding grooves. Now it's kind of tight in here. Now Nintendo went to right about here with it. I just pulled off the original and it's kind of tough to get in here. Let me see if we can get it started up here. Might have to get a piece of wood or something to bang that in. Camera's kind of in my way too. Let me come around here. Let's see if we can bang this in. There we go. All right, so we got it started there. And I know you guys have seen me do T-molding before, but usually I throw a staple on the bottom just so it doesn't come off. And I always do that on the bottom just because it's kind of out of sight. So let me get my pneumatic staple gun here. And I'm just gonna throw just a couple staples in there. Boy, the tripod is really in my way. God darn it. Okay. All right, so now we need to make this bend here. And you gotta cut the barb a little bit to make the bend. And I usually use my side cutters. Where are they? So we're just gonna get our side cutters and cut a little bit of the barb so we can make this corner here, okay? And I'm going to come in here. Let's see if we even need to do it. We might not need to, but let's just do this real quick. And this just kind of relieves the stress on the barb on itself. And it can make that corner real nice. Just like so. All right, so let's get our hammer. And again, I got 22 feet of T-molding. Typically, you can get 20 feet for a cabinet. And I usually get a little bit extra just to be safe. And Twisted Quarter sells it by the foot. And it's really cheap. I think the T-molding was about $8 or so. Actually, you know what? I take that back. I was going to order it from their website. And I didn't because they wanted too much for the shipping. And so I went on their eBay store and they had 20-foot rolls. It was like $10 less on eBay than it was on their website. So that is a pro tip right there. If you're gonna buy stuff from Twisted Quarter, check eBay because a lot of times they're selling the same exact stuff on eBay for less, which is really weird. Okay, so let's, so now we have to make this little curve here and I might, maybe we won't have to cut the barb. Let's see. Okay, how about this one here? It's going on nice. And just use a rubber mallet, take your time. And yeah, for once, the T-molding groove is pretty good on this cabinet. Okay, that's coming here. Stuff going in really nice. And I'm just coming on the side and looking to make sure it's all the way in. Okay, so the bottom here, like the last few inches, I can't really do with the cabinet on its back. So I'm just gonna trim it a little longer than I need it. And then we'll finish it off. We'll finish it off when we stand the cabinet off, cabinet up. So I'm gonna come in here with some little cutters here. And I'm just gonna cut off more than I need by a couple inches. And then we'll finish it off when we stand the game up. All right, so that went on pretty smooth. So let's try our trimmer, and we'll trim as much of it as we can, and then we'll finish it off when we stand it up. So let's get that trimmer, and it's probably a wise idea to start here on the bottom. Now, we're not gonna be able to get to the other side, because this thing kind of wants to go on both sides, right? And you could take this apart, like so, it's two pieces. And they call it a pneumatic trimmer because it's not spring-loaded, it's air that's, you know, it's got little O-rings right here. It's kind of neat. So what we're gonna try to do here is I'm gonna, because we can't get on the other side, let's see if, oh no, we can't do that there. So this thing is gonna be of no use to us on the bottom here because we cannot get on both sides of the cabinet. That's a bummer. So we're gonna have to maybe come in here with an X-Acto blade and do the bottom by hand. But let's see how it works in here. Let's try it in this area. Oh yeah, look at that. That's fantastic. I wanna make sure it doesn't dig into my cabinet though. So it's gonna be interesting how it handles these curves. So let's see how it works. Let's go up this way. So on curves, it's a bit tricky here. I can't get in here and do it though. So I wonder if we can take one side of it, go like this. So this thing is not perfect because like these areas we can't get to. All right, well, it's pretty awesome in some areas and not awesome in others. We're gonna have to take our X-Acto blade and trim it in here. I don't know how else to go about it. And it doesn't really go around corners. But like in here, it's freaking awesome. All right, well, we're gonna have to do this all by hand then, I guess, with my X-Acto blade. Can't think of any other way to go about this. So let's see if we can carefully come in here. Don't want to eat into the cabinet. This is actually working okay. Well, this isn't, that tool is great, but I was really hoping I didn't have to do what I'm doing right now with it. So it's obviously only good for big straightaways with lots of clearance. And not so hot on the turns. So I'm just coming in here with a blade and I'm just trimming the excess by hand. This is kind of a pain in the butt. All right, so I'm gonna keep going and just trim off the excess by hand with the X-Acto blade, and then I'll be back. Guys, I got the T-molding all on, stood the game up. In general, I'm not mega happy with how it turned out. It's good enough, but you know, trimming the T-molding with a blade is a little hairy, and so I did an okay job. The dual cutter thing did an awesome job in these long straightaways, but on the corners and stuff, the edges, it was really not ideal, and I did an okay job, but I just didn't, it doesn't look as finished as I wanted to, but it's okay. I mean, it looks good, but you can really scrutinize it and see that cutting it by hand is not really ideal at all. And I don't know if there's a better way to do it that I'm not aware of, but that dual cutter thing just cannot do corners. It cannot go around the corner. And I tried and tried, and I even tried like this, and you know, it just gets to a point where it can't cut, especially on these inside corners down here. It was pretty much useless right here. I mean, I couldn't do anything with it like right in here. So I had to come in with my blade and just trim it off. It's okay. I don't know. I think if I had to do this again, with these Nintendo cabinets, I might seek out a different way of doing it. But in general, though, I mean, if you look at it, you can't notice. I think it looks okay. The game is coming together here, but All right, so the last big thing I had to, I have to do a couple things still, but we gotta change the sight art, because we're missing the sight art on the other side, and so I want to have them matching. I don't want to just replace one side because it's a newer reproduction from Rich at This Old Game, and this side's okay. It's got some marks here, but really I should replace both sides at the same time, just so they look identical. So what I need to do first is, I need to get the old side art off, and I did take my tape measure, and I measured here, and it's 2 inches from this edge and 2 inches from the top. So when we go to put the new stuff on, we're gonna do the same exact thing. So 2 inches from the top and 2 inches from the back. And I'm wondering if I can just peel it off by hand. I started to. I think it's gonna start delaminating on me. This is potentially not gonna be fun. Might have to get my heat gun. I'm really hoping I can just pull it off in one piece. I gotta tell you, I'm sick of this project. I don't want to work on one of these games ever again. I don't like these particle board cabinets. They're garbage. I just don't want to work on one of these ever again. I don't. I'm just telling you. These Nintendo cabs that are made out of particle board are just junk. All right, I'm gonna have to get my heat gun. This is not gonna work. We'll see, yeah, there's no way. So, all right, let me get my heat gun and we'll see if we can get this sight art off. This is not gonna be fun. I can tell already. This is going to suck. And then we're gonna have all kinds of adhesive mess on here. All right, let me grab my heat gun. Sight art off. That was a total pain in the butt. But I'm gonna take some Goo Gone and just get the adhesive off of here. Now you can see we have these bolts for the monitor, and we're gonna have to remove those to get the sight art on, and then also remove those to get the remainder remnants off. When you put sight art on, you gotta remove these monitor bolts. You cannot put the sight art over them. That's just Bush League. Don't do that. So. All right, so I'm gonna come through here and just clean this up a little bit. I'm just using Goo Gone. I'm hoping it just kind of gets all this adhesive off. All right, we're all clean here. I got all the goo off of the cabinet. And so now I want to take these bolts off, and these bolts here are doing nothing, actually. If you look in the cabinet, they're just right there. And I'm not sure why Nintendo did that. I think that, actually I do know why they did that, because these holes here are for the vertical brackets, and then the other holes are used for the horizontal monitor brackets. So this was kind of a universal cabinet that could have been vertical or horizontal. And actually, thinking about it though, this cabinet was never used for any vertical games, so not sure why they put those in there. Maybe they thought down the road that they were gonna do that or something. So anyway, I'm gonna come in here and I'm just gonna just undo all these bolts. Now, when I pull these bolts off on the bottom here, the monitor is gonna wanna fall out. And so we gotta be careful about that. What we're gonna do is stick them back in from the other side, just so it supports the weight of the monitor. So let's go ahead and just pull these off. Okay, and then we'll just put these to the side. And then the other ones are supporting weight. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna remove them, and then I'm gonna put them in back in from the other side, but not all the way in. And we just gotta kind of be careful here that we don't really bump them out because the monitor could fall. So I'm gonna pull this nut out, and then I'm gonna come back in from this side and just stick it in here, not all the way through though, just so it does kind of support the weight. So let's go ahead and get this. Alright. And we'll just kind of come in here and just stick this guy in there. So right now all the weight's on this one. Off of this and then get it out. Alright. Okay. So let's just stick this in here. Alright, so now the monitor is not going to fall out. Okay. So we've got all those bolts off. Now we can come on this side and, well, we got to get our little remnants off first because we've got these little guys. So I'm going to go ahead and just clean this up really fast, get these last little pieces off, and then we'll get ready to put our new side art on. Okay, so we're all clean, we're all ready. Everything is prepared, and so now we gotta just put the side art on. And I'm gonna use Rapid Tack, okay? And here's the artwork right here. Richard Thistlegame printed this out for me. So again, we gotta go two inches from the top and 2 inches from the back, because that's how it was on here originally. And I'm wondering, is this side art the exact same size as the stuff I pulled off? I'm trying to see if I can see little, yep, okay, I can see it used to be right here. And that's 2 inches and 2 inches. So let me get some tape. I can, if I kind of just look to the side, I can kind of see where the curve is of the old side art. And I'm gonna kind of use that as a guide. Just from all those years of, who knows, smoke or whatever. I might have to get the white tape because this blue tape doesn't hold very well. The cheap tape though, I used that before when I was masking the bottom, and it left like adhesive residue all over the bottom of the cabinet. I mean, this white tape is just super cheap, but it really does stick. So I'm just gonna kind of loosely get it in position right now, and then we'll tweak it. So I make sure we're straight. Okay. And then I'm gonna take my tape measure and I'm just gonna do like some spot checks here. So from here to here is about 2 1/8. From here to here, it's a little over 2. So as long as we're really close to 2, I'm okay. It should come back just a hair, I think. I'm tempted to just, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna do some tape guides and we'll just use that as a guide. Let me get my square. Here it is. And I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to come in 2 inches. And I'm going to mark it off with tape. So let's go across the top here. And then we'll use this as a guide. I'm gonna be running out of tape soon. Okay. All right, so let's see what we got. So that's just short of 2 inches. And that right there is just short of 2 inches. So the tape is not quite 2 inches wide. So we need to come down just a smidge, maybe an eighth of an inch. I think I'm just gonna do a tape guide, top and right, and then we'll just use that to help line up our sight art. And we just need to be about an eighth of an inch away from it. Okay, let's try this. Going to try to put a little eighth inch gap in between the sight art and our tape, and but use the tape as a guide to help keep it straight. Right there. It's coming up. And then, you know, Rich puts a little too much paper on here, so I'm going to cut this back so I can just see what's going on. That looks pretty good right there. That looks straight. And then let's kind of do some spot tests down here. So what I want to do is I'm going to measure from here to here. That's 2 inches exactly. And I want to get exactly 2 inches down here. Just right there. All right, let me get a piece of tape. Putting sight art on isn't really hard. It's just, you gotta just make sure you got it in the right position before you go for it. And it can be a little time consuming. So right now I'm coming on the bottom and I wanna measure 2 inches from the side of the cabinet. Our sight art. Just right there. Let's see. Right there. Okay. Oh, for God's sake. Two inches. All right. So it's 2 inches. And then on the top here, I've got 2 inches all the way across. So it's exactly in the right spot. So if I come up here, 2 inches, and then on the right side, that's exactly two. This side needs to come down just a smidge. Right there. All right, so let's go ahead. All right, so now I'm gonna just tape up the top here. All right, let's do some checks here. Two. All right, good. All right, so what we're gonna do is just tape up the top part and then we're gonna apply the bottom first.
think that's gonna go anywhere.
Okay, so here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna do the wet method. I'm gonna use Rapid Tack. And I'm low on it, so hopefully I have enough here to get through this. So this is Rapid Tack. You can buy this, where did I buy this? I bought this from a sign making shop online. But I don't know if Amazon has it. I bet you they do by now. But it's good. It is designed for vinyl, for people who do vinyl signs for a living. And it helps with bubbles and creases and all that stuff. And it also allows you to reposition the artwork if you screw up. And hopefully we won't screw up. So what we're going to do is you want to use this to clean the cabinet first. So I'm going to come in here and just spray a little. And then we'll wipe it off, and we're gonna use that to just kind of clean it. So clean it and wipe it off. Okay. All right, and then we're gonna spray it again. Okay. And then we're gonna take our paper, peel it back, and then we're gonna cut it with scissors. All right, so let's peel this back. And then I'm gonna take my scissors and cut as straight as line as possible. Okay. And then we're gonna take our little squeegee here, and we're going to apply our side art. And right now I'm just trying to push the liquid out and any air bubbles that we might be getting, like right there. Didn't like that. Getting some air bubbles here. Bubble right here. Okay. Okay, I'm just feeling around looking for any air bubbles. There's a bunch over here. Some of these air bubbles, I can't tell if they're between the artwork and the mask or between the artwork and the cabinet. Yeah, they're in the mask. They're not in the artwork. Okay, so, all right, so the bottom half's done. So now we're gonna just undo all of our tape here and do the top half. Taking, I don't want to take the mask with it. I feel like I've done this a gazillion times. I've probably done it, I don't know, 10, 20 times in my life. But I feel like I've done it a gazillion times. All right, let's clean up a little bit with this. All right. So now we're going to do it for real. So let's pull our backer off. I'm just going to pull it all the way off. All right. I'm just trying to get the adhesive off. I mean, the wrap attack. Just kind of pushing it to the sides to get the liquid out. And when you get the liquid out, you get the air bubbles out at the same time. Big one. There's one right here. I'm just feeling around now for air bubbles, and if I see any, I'm gonna push them to the side. Some right here. Just push them out. Okay, I think that's pretty good. I know we've done this a bunch of times in these videos. It is a major part of this hobby. And the first time I put sight art on, holy cow, was I scared. Control panel overlays are scarier, but this is scary too the first time you do it. All right, so they say to spray this mask with Wrap Attack. I'm not going to do that because I don't have enough to spare for that. So let's just see what happens if we just try to pull it off. Rich does a good job. I could tell already this is going to look good. And this is digitally printed. Looks good, right? Looks real good. All right, how do we do? I think we did pretty good, actually. I'm not seeing any air bubbles at all. So I'm gonna wipe this down. Let's get all that gunk off the So we do have some air bubbles over here. Let's see if we can push those out. Right here. Gotta be careful when you do this because you can kink the side art trying to get the air bubble out. But that just came out real nice. And there's one right here. And I'm using the felt end of this thing right here so we don't scratch our side art.
That bubble's gone. All right. A little bit of an air bubble up here, right on the edge. Okay, that looks pretty good. There's an air bubble right here. So just gonna push it to the edge. There we go. Okay. And then if the air bubble is like right in the middle and it's really tiny, I suggest taking a little pin and just popping it. Because it's really hard to push tiny, tiny air bubbles all the way to the edge. All right, and I'm just kind of looking here. I think we did a really good job. It looks perfect. We did not screw anything up. Thank God. There's a little air bubble down here. Let's see if we can push this one to the edge. See, this one's tiny and it's hard to get to the edge. This one might be when I pop. All right, well, oh, I almost got it. There it goes. All right. All right, guys, I think that's good. We're done. I keep finding little air bubbles. All right, that one's gone. All right, we're done there. Okay, so what we need to do now is we need to put our bolts back on. And so why don't we do these two right here first, because these ones were just cosmetic. And when you do this, you got to be a little careful because it'll twist the side art. So try to... So here's the holes right here. If possible, cut a little bit away around it. Let's see what happens though. Actually, this is gonna be just fine. But what happens is when you tighten this down, the side art can twist. If the bolt can twist, these bolts can't twist because they're square holes. So it's in the head of the carriage bolt also is square. Looks legit. So I'm just gonna come inside here and tighten it. And so I'm gonna go ahead and do the same thing for the monitor. And then the monitor, I'm just gonna pull them from the inside one at a time. And so the middle one comes right out. It's the loosest. Really it. Just pull them out and then stick them in from the other side and tighten them down. So I'm going to go ahead and tighten these all down, and then we're going to do the other side of side art exactly the same way that we did this side. Thank you.
Okay, guys, side art is on. To do this side, I had to take the monitor out. There was just no other way because the bracket here, you could not get to those screws with the monitor in. So I ended up taking the monitor out, which I could have done on this side too, and I guess it would have been easier all around. So in the future, just remember on the Versus unit systems, you gotta take the monitor out to really put the side art on. But this side looks pretty good. This art looks great, actually. Rich did a really good job printing it. I feel pretty good about my work. It's nice and square, no bubbles. It's funny though, because when the side art is shipped, it's rolled up and you get little creases in the artwork and the mask. And that kind of creates little issues for you when you're applying it. And you think when you're doing it that it's your fault, but really the crease was there originally. And I started like freaking out about some of this stuff, but because I had these little creases, I ended up having no problem getting rid of them, but it was just kind of annoying because a lot of it was just how it was shipped or it was damaged during shipping. So anyway, I put the monitor in. I definitely need to make sure that I tighten this down. I also simple green the whole bottom of the cabinet, which it really needed it. It was just kind of dusty down there. Not really gross, but just dusty. So I'm gonna come in here and I wanna make sure this is nice and tight because I do not want this monitor falling out during transit because this thing's gonna be shipped. So I'm gonna come in here with my screwdriver and just really, really hand tighten these guys. Okay, and I definitely want to Windex that. Now there is a cardboard bezel that goes over this, but let's clean the tube really fast. we are at the finish line. We are just about done. We have a couple loose ends to take care of though. One is the power supply, because we're gonna replace the power supply. Because the power supply that's in here now, I have no idea how old it is. It looks very old. It is non-original. The power supply that's in here. Originally, this had a Nintendo switching power supply, and somebody at some point hacked in a different switching power supply, a little bit more modern, maybe more common. I'm okay with that. Normally, I would not do that. I would not. I would try to find another Nintendo one. The Nintendo power supplies, though, didn't really put out unique voltages, and they were just switching power supplies. The only voltage that was unique was for the coin counter. I think it was 24 volts. So right now the coin counter is not working on this game. That's really okay. And this is going to be a home use game, so I'm okay if we lose the coin counter. So there was this black cardboard bezel that kind of goes right over this, and it's got four little Velcro tabs. So let's kind of come in here and put this back on. It's a little dusty. I think I'm going to wipe it down after I get it in position. I'm just going to take some paper towel with a little bit of Simple Green on it, and let's just wipe this down a little bit. See if we can get some of this dust off. Not too bad. All right, so this kind of goes in like so, and then there's Velcro in the corners. 1, 2, 3, 4, and then they taped it on the top where it meets with the back piece. I don't know if you guys can see that. And that looks like factory too. So they have tape on the top. I don't know if I'm gonna worry about recreating that. I think it'll be fine. Position here. All right, that looks pretty good. All right. So we got our cardboard bezel in, our monitor is nice and clean, so we can put the glass back on. And I definitely want to clean the glass, the inside of it, before I put it in its final resting place. I don't like how this is not sitting flat. Good. All right,
always want to make sure your tube is clean before you button the game up. Because there's nothing more annoying than putting the whole game together and realizing the tube is dirty. And then same thing with the inside of the glass. So I'm going to spray the inside of the glass and then we're going to put it on. And I'm going to come over here with some Windex and just spray it real quick. All right, I had the glass all clean. Now there is a scratch in the glass. I'm going to try to put it in a spot where you won't see it, like on the bottom. And so I cleaned the inside, but not the outside yet. Okay. And then let me get the control panel. Let's just wipe the bottom of this a little bit. Okay. So let's get the control panel. Oh my God, we're almost done. So close. I am really officially ready to be done though. The time is now. It is time to move on with my life and just get this thing away from me. We worked on it, I don't know, a lot of hours, honestly. Like this weekend here, I've got at least 12 hours of work, at least, probably more. I probably have, 30 to 40 hours in this restore. And there's a lot more we could have done, I guess. We fixed everything that was really wrong. So let's come down here, and I'm gonna latch that. And also latch this. This harness, I believe, goes over here on a little hook. The one that goes at a coin door, okay. And I should probably wipe this up a little bit in here. And then this bottom coin door, have I ever opened this? I don't think I have. Do we have a key? Yeah, we have a key. Do we have the key for that? Let me see. I'm gonna have to replace the locks. Because we don't have a key for that. Okay, we do have a key for this. And there is one single quarter in here. 1987. And then we'll clean this up in here. Definitely need to clean that up. So I'm gonna go ahead and wipe this all down with some Simple Green and then I'll be right back. All right, it's all clean up here, cleaned up. Just tying up a few loose ends. I wanna replace the bulb in the starter because it looks like they're original. And also there were some screws missing here. So I just went to the hardware store and got some number 8 screws, like half inch. And I'm just gonna just replace these screws that are missing that hold this channel down. And I'll probably use these screws up here too for the marquee, top of the marquee bracket. So let me go ahead and just replace all these. There's some little dings right here. I'm tempted to pull this off and see if I can nail that out, hammer that. But it's the way it's connected to this, I don't think it's like a flat piece I can put on the ground. And I might end up making it worse. So I'm hesitant to do that. I suppose I could just try. All right, let me get this last screw in here. Okay, I got those 4 screws in, and then I started trying to take this off. I took them off. I'm trying to take this part off. I don't know how to get this piece off. This piece, this metal piece here, I have no clue how to get this off. It's really in there, so I don't know. And then I went on a crazy tangent down in the bottom of the cabinet off camera. I noticed that there was some ground wires cut, so I added them back in. And so I made a ground wire right here that goes down. So I made it connect to this thing,
which will then ground the control panel. And then I also added a ground wire going to the coin door, because it looks like there originally was these ground wires and someone had cut them. So I just put them back in, and I didn't really intend to do that just then, but I just went on this crazy tangent. All right, so I want to change the bulb in the starter. I also want to change the coin door lights too. So the bulb and the starter are unique to Nintendo, because this is a 100-volt bulb, okay? And the starter is like this screw-in glass thing. And these can be hard to find, but if you go on my website, johnsarcade.com, go to my Donkey Kong page, I list links to where you can buy these bulbs in the U.S. I don't normally replace the whole unit, because these usually almost always work, especially after you replace the bulb in the starter. So I like to keep it original, because again, it is 100 volts. And you know, the light fixtures you get like at Home Depot or something, or Walmart, are rated for 120, 110, 120. But I don't know, I just like keeping it original. So these are this is either from Top Bulb or Bulbtronics. It's plastic, but it works. And I've got these in all my games. So let me go ahead and screw the starter in. And then here's a new bulb. The bulb is an F10T8. This is the brand Eco. Again, these are on, I think it's Top Bulb is where I got these ones from. They're really cheap too. They're like $2. All right, so let's plug the game in and see if everything's still working. And also before we change the power supply, because that is the last thing to do now, is to change the power supply. I also need to put a new plug on here, because the plug I have on there now is missing the ground plug. All right, so the bulb works, game works, okay. I want to change the coin door bulbs, and let's do that right now. I don't know if they're 12 volt or 5 volt though. Let me get my multimeter, and we're going to test them really fast. Where is my multimeter? This garage is so trashed. It is such a mess in here. Oh my God. All right, let's go down here. I just want to quickly just see if these are 12 or 5 volt bulbs. I'm hoping they're 5 volt, because those are just standard, like pinball type 555s or 444s. So I'm just going to come here with my meter and just test it. Test the voltage going to the light. This is going to give me a clue. I actually pulled the bulbs out earlier, and come on, I'm not getting anything. I pulled the bulbs out earlier, and I couldn't read what they were. All right, they're 5 volts. Good. Okay, so we're going to change these really quick. So for 5 volts, we're just going to use these. These are 4-4s. I always get these confused. Yeah, 4-4s. So you can buy these. These are all over pinball machines. So I always have tons of these bulbs on hand. So let's go ahead and pull this out. Look at that, one's really dim. So this is gonna probably make a bit of a difference here. It's still kind of dim. Why is that so dim? Let's see. Let's go ahead and throw. I'm doing this with the game on, but I'm being careful. Boy, those are really dim. Let me just make sure I put in the right bulb here. I'm not positive, but I think I just put 12 volt bulbs in. Let me go in the basement and get, I think these are 161s I put in there, which are 12 volt. That's why it's so dim. Let me go get some 5 volt bulbs. I'll be back. All right, I went and grabbed some 4-4s. I'm pretty sure that those were 161s. The box lid was ripped off, and I was having trouble reading what the bulb actually said on it, but I bet you these are going to be way brighter. Something tells me I was using 12 volt bulbs. Let's see. Yeah, way better. Okay, good. All right, so that's that. So what we need to do, actually, I want to plug the control panel in. Let's make sure everything still works. Because before I mess with the control panel, I mean with the power supply, I just want to make sure that whatever, if something stops working, I want to know that it was related to what I just did and not something I did a long time ago, if that makes sense. All right, so let's put this back like so. All right, I'm gonna lock this down. Oh my God, we are 20 minutes away from being done. All right, let me turn the game back on and let's just try everything out. That was in the bottom of the game, by the way. Vintage 85 Hogan's Alley, $895. Okay, so let's make sure everything's working here. There is a credit button on there that I'm actually gonna leave alone because I think that credit button is gonna be fine for a home use setting for someone who's not an arcade collector. So I'm gonna leave that button where it is. And it's real discreet on the coin door. All right, so the game, everything's working. All right, good. Okay, so let's go in the back here and we're gonna put the power supply on. So let me show you what someone did. Cause somebody basically hacked a power supply in here. So it's not original. And honestly, I'm kind of okay with it because this game's gonna leave me and I will not be there to be able to fix things or replace things. So we're gonna put a brand new power supply in here, a modern, super high quality HAP one. And this is like the super deluxe HAP Power Pro. This power supply is 35, 40 bucks or something. It's the best one they make. And I love this power supply actually. Never had any issues with this in any game I put it in. So we're gonna use this power supply and replace this very generic ugly one right here. So I'm trying to figure out where we're gonna put it. I'm tempted to put it up here, like so, if these wires will reach, and I'm not sure if they will. We could mount it to the side here, which is how the original was. Okay, I think what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna move the old wires from the old power supply to the new power supply one at a time. That way I don't have to worry about what's what because these are all labeled. They're grabbing the AC over here. Looks like it's through the isolation transformer. And I'm just gonna move the AC wires from here to here. Now the game is off, it's unplugged. You know, don't start touching the AC wires until you're confident that the game is off and unplugged, and it is now. So I'm just gonna move the AC now. So they cut the harness up, and I'm okay with it. It's not the ideal situation, but it is what it is, and I'm just gonna put this modern supply in here because I think, again, long term, it's gonna be more reliable for this person. All right, so let's. Just moving the AC wires from the one to the next exactly the same way. And I'm just gonna keep going here. First I'll move the AC, then we'll move the field ground, then we're gonna move the 5 volts and the 12 volts. Looks like there's a 15 volt. That's interesting. Look at this power supply. Does that say 15 volts? No, 5. Okay.
Yeah, this supply is 5 volts, 12 volts, negative 5. So, all right, I moved my AC wires. I'm going to go ahead and keep moving the rest of them one at a time. Next is field ground, then 5 volts, then ground, and then 12 volts. And I'm just going to move one from the old to the new.
All right, I moved all the wires, so let's get rid of this old junky power supply here. And we got to figure out a way to mount it. The original was mounted on the side of the cage, just like this is. But it wasn't mounted exactly like this, but it was mounted here. Oh man, that's really on there. There we go.
So I'm gonna see if I could screw it to this cage, because that would be the easiest. All right, so that is moving on the inside. This thing's gonna be a pain in the butt to get off, isn't it? Let's see. So they used one existing screw here, and then they added another one. We might do kind of the same scheme, we'll see. All right, so we put this to the side, and then they put a nut on the inside here. So let me get some pliers on the inside, and let me get that nut off, and we'll get this junky one off. All right, I just used two sheet metal screws. I got the old one out, and I just threw sheet metal screw through here and through the bottom, and it's screwed onto the side here real tight. And the only thing left to do is to put our field ground back on, which was grounded to this RF cage. So let's go ahead and do that, because we definitely need this ground. And which screw was it that was holding it on? Where did I put that screw? So there's a screw that goes over here that I just lost. Oh, here it is. All right, so let's go ahead and ground our power supply to the RF cage. Like so. All right, guys, we're pretty much done. We got to check our voltages. This thing really should have a loop on it and not this C, you know. I'm going to crimp on a little loop thing. That way the screw can't fall off. So take a second. At this point, might as well do it right. So I don't know if an operator added this or what, but it's not original. So we're gonna come in here. And we're just going to crimp one of these on. It's almost 7 o'clock. I've been out here today. I came out here about 10:30. It has been a long day of arcade restoring. I want to be done. This is it. This is the last part, the very last thing to do. I already put the ground plug on. I did that off camera. Sorry. I replaced the plug, the AC plug, because it was missing the ground prong. I wanted to do that before I started messing with the power supply, just to make sure our ground was ground. All right, so we've got that. Just curious, if I were to take my multimeter, and if I went continuity, and I go from field to ground, if I go from field ground on here to the ground plug, it should beep. And if it does, then we know we got our field ground is all set up right. Yep. So that thing's all grounded properly. Okay, so let's take a peek in here. There's one little connector that is just hanging here, and I'm pretty positive that this was the 24 volts they did not bother to hook up for the coin counter. So I'm just gonna cut this back just because it's, I don't like how it looks just hanging back, just hanging out here. So let's just get rid of that. So this all looks fairly neat. I think I'm gonna get some zip strips. Now this is not gonna be the final configuration. Actually, let's unplug the board and I wanna dial in my 5 volts. And let's plug the game in because I wanna test the 5 volts before we plug the logic board in. Because this is a brand new power supply, I don't know how it's dialed in from the factory. They usually almost are always dialed in, but I don't want to take any chances. So let's turn it on with the PCB unplugged. Okay. All right. So let's go ahead and test our 5 volts. All right. And put it on DC volts. So let's go here and let's see, we're gonna go ground and 5 volts. So our 5 volt tab is right here. And then ground. 5.164, so that is high. So let's dial it down. You're really supposed to do this under load, but I don't wanna put it under load until I know it's right on the money. So let's come in here again. So it goes minus, so it's the third one. 5 volts and ground. So it's 5.06, that's good. All right, so let's turn this off and let's plug our board in. And right now I don't have the RF cage on, there's like an RF board that goes on here that I actually usually do leave on. But right now it's removed, just because I'm swapping boards. All right, let's turn this on. And let's go to the front and make sure everything still works. And there's our game. It's good. All right. Sound works. All right, good. All right. So we're done. I mean, there's one thing left to do. There's a couple things left to do. But we got our new ground plug. We got our power supply installed. It looks nice and tidy inside. Our game looks good. It is so dirty in here. Look at this garage. It's a freaking mess. Oh my God. But hey, you know what? Look at this thing. It looks really good. That is a very good looking game. We did it all. We fixed all the flaws. And I think it actually does look really good. I'm proud of it. And then the inside here, we got a new power supply. And we cleaned up the inside. The monitor we capped in a previous video. I think the way the power supply is installed right there looks pro. That looks legit and right. So I guess, well, the only thing right now is to put the marquee on. You guys want to do that? You want to put the marquee on? All right, let's get the marquee over here. So I had the marquee over here, and this is a custom marquee that Rich at This Old Game made for me. And so why don't we go ahead and put it on the game? There you have it. That was the Nintendo versus Unisystem Restore, and we are done. That game is done and ready to go. It is, and I'm pretty excited and happy, to be honest, because I don't know why, but I wasn't enjoying myself doing this restore. I don't know what it was. If it's the particle board cabinet, I don't know. There was just something about it. It was very tedious. Lots of little tiny things we had to take care of in this video series. But we're all done now, and that game is ready to ship. And I'm honestly, I'm stoked. I'm jazzed. I'm happy. I want that game out of here.
I'm done with it. So anyway, I will reveal what that game is very soon. I can't tell you just yet until the person gets it. And maybe we'll interview the person as well when they receive the game. That could be kind of cool. So anyway, all right, let's move on and do some verses, some viewer mail. And I printed out three of these here. And if you want to participate in the viewer mail segment, you want to email them to me at blkdog7@gmail.com. That's blkdog7@gmail.com. In the subject line, please put viewer mail. All right, so the first one here is from Chuck. It says, "Hey, John, I love the videos. I just watched the iRobot graphics video. Being a pre-press graphics person myself, I like seeing what you did to fix up that scan. While I don't have any arcade machines, I do have slot machines. I'm attaching some pictures of a project I just finished. The machine is an IGT S Plus slot. I cleaned up a lot of the surface rust, replaced the buttons with LEDs, and created new artwork." Okay, he rethemed it for the award glass with real strips and belly glass. The game is based on the slot machine called Haywire and will respin winning combinations from time to time. I call this game Family Guy Haywire. Hope you like it. This is pretty cool, actually. So he took a pretty common slot machine. This Haywire slot machine, I've actually seen a lot on Craigslist, okay? And he took it and he rethemed it with a Family Guy theme, okay? Which I think is actually really cool. So you can see here, here's like his, I don't know if you call this the back glass, but it's got the Family Guy characters. And he also customized the reels as well with Family Guy stuff. So yeah, that's pretty cool, man. You know, slot machines are funny because, you know, I've seen slot machines for sale quite a bit. And they're usually really inexpensive. And I have thought and considered getting a slot machine a lot, actually, like more than five times, you know, where I see them on Craigslist, it's like $100, and I'm like, that would be kind of fun to have. And you know what, I see a slot machine in my future. I'm not gonna lie here. I think that we'll have a slot machine at some point. I was looking at those Japanese ones. There is a slot machine for Golgo 13. G-O-L-G-O 13. Do you remember that game, Golgo 13, on the NES? That was a pretty awesome game. It was like this cool spy guy. He was a sniper. It was pretty mind-blowing at the time. And there is a Golgo 13 slot machine. And I've often thought about getting one of those. I've seen one of those in person at a flea market. And I could see myself getting something like that, so we'll see. But thanks for sharing your Haywire slot. That was pretty cool. All right, the next one here is from Kelsey, and it says, "Hey, John, my husband, Carl, is a huge fan of John's Arcade. He kind of freaks out if your Sunday videos don't come out on Sundays." You know what? This happens. You know, I can't help this. My intention is to put the video on. Okay, right now, it is Sunday right now, okay? It's because the video you just watched, I filmed all of that Saturday and Sunday. I finished filming that somewhere around 7 o'clock tonight on Sunday, 7 p.m., right? Then I ate dinner with my family. Then I came in the basement and I edited the video. And now I'm doing this thing right here. So you can see the clock behind me. That is the real time, right? It's almost 10 o'clock at night. Sunday, right? And I'm not done with the video yet. So my intention is to get the video out on Sunday, but it really is a lot of work to edit. I mean, the video for this week's episode was about 40 or 50 gigs worth of video. I mean, I had like 50 clips to deal with. And it is time consuming, guys. And so I'm trying my best to get it out on Sunday because I do the work on Saturday and Sunday. And I film and I film and I film and I try to release it. You know, I try to start editing around dinner time. And sometimes it's after, sometimes before, but whatever. So yes, this Sunday video is probably gonna be out late Monday, that's my guess. So I'm sorry, I'm doing my best here. Anyway, she says, "It would be awesome if you could give her husband, Carl, a shout out, okay, out on your show for his birthday, which is coming out on October 23rd. Now, did I do this wrong? because I'm doing this sooner than later, right? Well, Carl, I want to wish you a happy birthday, which is happening on October 23rd. and maybe you won't watch this until then, but Carl, thanks for watching my videos. And she also says, he hopes to meet up with you in person one of these days. Keep up the good work, Kelsey Perkins. P.S. He probably would be mad that I'm sending you this picture without the games all lit up and looking sweet. That's just part of his collection in the newly finished basement. Definitely having an arcade party for his birthday. All right, this is awesome. You know what? I actually have a lot of these emails where the wife emails me on behalf of the husband. I don't know what that's all about, but it does happen. So here's his basement. I notice he has two red tents, Nintendo versus dual systems. That's pretty cool. Of course, these little thumbnails are small. I think there's a RoboCop right there. It looks like a great room. There's a pinball machine over here. Looks pretty awesome. So Carl, I want to say happy birthday and thank you for watching my videos. I know your birthday is on October 23rd, but I just want to wish you an early happy birthday and thank you for watching all the videos. And your wife seems super cool. So, all right. So next one here is from Wayne. Now this one is really long. Okay, and I am gonna read it just because this person put a lot of effort into emailing me. And I actually get a lot of these really long emails, and I have to admit, I typically shut down when I get them because it's a big investment to read this, okay? And I do get a lot of emails every week, and I try to read every single one. I can't reply to all of them, and I can't read all of them on the show. But every now and then, I will read one of these long ones because a lot of effort went into this, and it means a lot to me to get something this thoughtful, and I know that the person that wrote it put a lot of effort into it, so I'd like to share these types of emails from time to time. So this one is from Wayne. He says, hey John. All right, and it's a long email. I'm gonna go as fast as I can. All right, it's from Wayne. He says, hey John, first off, let me just say I'm a huge fan. I've been visiting your website and YouTube channel for the last couple years, and I've watched almost all of your videos. You have a real passion for arcade games, and your excitement is infectious. You get so excited about the games you review that it gets me excited. Anyway, your warmth, personality, and knowledge are what keep me coming back to your videos again and again, and I can't thank you enough for sharing so much of yourself with your viewers. Well, thank you. Whether it's a tour of your basement arcade, insight into buying and fixing old arcade games, or really interesting factoids about old arcade games and their developers, you never fail to entertain. You always seem to answer my question as they pop in my head. Watching your videos, I might think, I wonder how he shuts off all those games tonight. And then you show us the switches at the top of your basement stairs. Or I wonder, often you ask the question, is this something you guys want to know? Are you curious? On behalf of myself and everyone, every other like-minded arcade lover out there, let me take this opportunity to answer your question. Yes, 1,000 times yes, we watch your videos because we're hungry for what you have to share with us. Some of your viewers have home arcades and they're hoping to learn from you. However, many of us don't own a single arcade game. I've noticed this and I've heard this, and it's always interesting to me that a lot of guys that watch the videos don't have any arcade games at all. He says, we may want to have our own home arcades, but to whatever reason, financial, space, wives, our basements are barren, devoid of Donkey Kongs and Cuberts and Popeyes. Your detailed videos give us hope, insight, and escapism. Three things that man cannot live without. You keep your audience informed and entertained. That is the mark of a great video blogger, my friend. So for all that and more, again, I thank you. Well, Wayne, this is very, very awesome. Thank you so much. He goes on, just to give you some background on me, I'm 35. I grew up in the arcades. The first arcade game I fell in love with all the way back in 85 when I was in kindergarten is Space Harrier, the stand-up, not the sit-down. I've played many of the games you have in your basement, and I've enjoyed them. But for me, the arcade games that came in the 90s are some of my favorites, especially X-Men 6-player, Mortal Kombat 2, Samurai Showdown, Killer Instinct, Time Traveler, NBA Jam, Gotham Legends, just to name a few. But I really love some of the 80s classics too, like Power Drift, Black Tiger, Russian Attack, Rygar, Legend of Cage versus Mario, Afterburner, Stand Up, and Sit Down, all great games I played for many hours as a kid. One game that I played a lot on my Nintendo and later on MAME is a little known classic that I consider one of the best ever. It's a game called Solomon's Key. I know that game. Actually, I bought Solomon's Key not that long ago on the Wii U Virtual Store. I don't know why, but I did. It is a fun game. Have you ever seen a Solomon's Key arcade cabinet? I have not. I've never actually played a vintage one, but man, I really love to. Solomon's Key is an all-time top three. At this point in my life, the list goes Mortal Kombat 2, Solomon's Key, and Space Harrier in that order. Hell, I would even settle for just seeing a picture of the Solomon's Key cabinet art, but no one seems to have one. Not Google Image Search, not even the International Arcade Museum. I'm guessing that Solomon's Key the arcade version was sold as a kit. And maybe it didn't have all that artwork and all that. This is a long email, I told you. Anyway, he goes, but I digress. At this point, I'm starting to ramble, so I'll wrap things up by asking one more question and making a suggestion. The question first, will you be going to PAX South this year? I will not. I go to PAX East, and that's really it. And that's kind of local to me in Boston. I haven't been to PAX Prime or South or Australia or any of those other ones. I'd love to go if they'd have me, but no, I'm not planning on going to PAX South. He says, I'm going to be going with my girlfriend and her brother. It's my first PAX and I'm extremely excited that they have an arcade. I'll keep an eye out for you there. I'd like to shake your hand and shoot the shit about it. What else? Arcade games, of course. Other fun pop culture stuff too. Moving on and finishing up, I'd like to make a minor suggestion. In your videos, I've seen your basement arcade and I know you have that popcorn maker right here. But what about the pop? In Youngstown, Ohio, where I'm from, we called Coca-Cola pop. You know, I'm from the Midwest, Chicago area. When I was a kid, we called soda pop. That's what my mom and dad said. I have since grown out of that, but when I was a kid, I said pop. I said, I'd like some pop, you know, can I have some pop? You know, that is what I said. So, it's not strange to me, but it's weird though. I've gotten away from saying that. I don't say pop anymore. It seems odd, but yes, I know all about it. When I was a kid, my favorite arcade, which sadly is now out of business, used to serve pitchers of Black Pop and Red Pop. They didn't call it Coke and Cherokee Red. They called it Black Pop and Red Pop. And my friends and I would mix them together to make Black Cherry Pop. That's kind of cool. Now, Cherokee Red, God, I seem to remember that. What is Cherokee Red soda? Is that just like a cherry soda? That seems familiar, but not at the same time. I don't know. You should consider adding some red and black pop to your basement arcade. I bet your kids would love it. Have a good one, man. If you don't get a chance to meet at PAX South, maybe we'll cross paths at Fun Spot one of these years. And by the way, BroFest 2 is happening the weekend after Memorial Day. That is confirmed. We are doing another tournament. We have taken over the Fun Spot annual tournament. So Gary, Vincent, and myself have been talking the last couple weeks. That is for sure happening. So save the dates. That is the weekend after Memorial Day, which I think is like June 2nd and 3rd. It's the Friday and Saturday. So anyway, I wasn't able to make BroFest this year, and I was totally crushed. If you guys have another one, I'll really try to be there. Yes, we're doing another one. Anyway, Wayne, P.S. I really loved your New Year's wrap-up video last year. Of all your videos, I think it's my favorite one. I've heard a lot of guys saying that they like the New Year's wrap-up videos. It's just like a two-hour casual video where we just take our time and talk about the game. So we'll be doing one of those again soon. Crazy. P.P.S. A totally random idea that just hit me out of nowhere. I swear I didn't have this in my pocket the whole time. It just came to me. Have you ever considered designing your own arcade cabinet and custom artwork? I'd really like to see a John's arcade cabinet and what it would look like. I think it would be amazing. Yeah, we've talked about that before. Maybe someday we'll do my own custom game. I don't know. I'd like to do one of my games, you know, with my buddy Matt McCarthy. You know, we do apps for iOS and Android. And I'd like to take one of our games or make a new game and maybe put it on an Ouya or some kind of Android-based gaming device and put it in a cabinet with custom artwork. That would be cool. So anyway, thank you for the long and thoughtful email, Wayne. I know you put a lot of work into that, and I really wanted to read that. And it means a lot. It truly does. You know, all the compliments and all the positive, comments that I get from everybody is very motivating, and I'm very appreciative, and I want you guys to know that. So anyway, all right, that's it. We're done. So by the way, this weekend I'll be at Grinker's Grand Palace again, October 9th and 10th. If you guys are thinking about going, please do go. Go to arcadeoutsiders.com. I have all the details there. This is a fun tournament. Joe, Sean, and myself will be there. So if you guys are really thinking about going, go to arcadeoutsiders.com for all the details. So, all right, that's going to do it for this video. Go to Video Game Outsiders and VideoGameOutsiders.com for my podcast and my other podcast, Arcade Outsiders at arcadeoutsiders.com. So, all right, guys, I know this is a long video, so we are done. I'll see you very soon. So, all right, guys, later and bye.